Lecture 11, Academic Writing, Adjective Clause. Objectives of the lecture. To define adjective clauses, to identify functions of adjective clauses, to specify essential, non-essential adjective clauses, to clarify the components of an adjective clause, to identify questions related to adjective clauses. Plan of the lecture. Adjective clauses, functions of adjective clauses, essential, non-essential adjective clauses, the components of an adjective clause, questions related to adjective clauses. An adjective clause, also known as a relative clause, is a type of dependent clause that works to describe a noun in a sentence. It functions as an adjective even though it is made up of a group of words instead of just one word. In the case of an adjective clause, all the words work together to modify the noun or pronoun. An adjective clause is a multi-word adjective that includes a subject and a verb. When we think of an adjective, we usually think about a single word used before a noun to modify its meanings. For example, tall building, smelly cat, argumentative assistant. However, an adjective can also come in the form of an adjective clause. An adjective clause usually comes after the noun, it modifies and is made up of several words which, like all clauses, will include a subject and a verb. All adjective clauses are dependent clauses. A dependent clause is a group of words that consist of a subject and a verb. Yet it is not a complete sentence that can stand alone. Adjective clauses begin with a relative pronoun, which connects them to the word they describe, such as that, where, when, who, whom, whose, which, why. Once you remember the relative pronouns, it's very easy to pick out an adjective clause in a sentence. Chocolate, which many people adore, is fattening. People who are smart follow the rules. I can remember the time when cell phones didn't exist. Charlie has a friend whose daughter lives in China. The reason why Sandra went to law school is that she didn't want to be a doctor. Notice that each of the italicized adjective clauses begins with a relative pronoun from the list above. This connects it to the noun being described, which comes directly before the relative pronoun in the sentence. Each adjective clause above also contains a subject and a verb, all of which work together to describe the original noun being modified. For example, the clause which many people adore contains a subject people and the verb adore. Yet by itself it is not a complete sentence. Instead, its job is to provide more information to describe the noun chocolate. In some cases, the relative pronoun also serves as the subject of the clause. For example, in the adjective clause, who are smart is a relative pronoun who also acts as the subject that is smart. With relative pronouns, an adjective clause generally begins with a relative pronoun, that, which, who, whom, whose, that connects the clause to the noun or pronoun it modifies. The relative pronoun shows the relationship between the clause and the antecedent. There is a mountain that we are going to climb. Antecedent mountain that connects the clause we are going to climb that with the antecedent. My blue tennis shoes, which used to be my mom's, were under the bed. Antecedent shoes, which is a pronoun replacing shoes in the dependent clause, shoes used to be my mom's, and relating it to the subject of the independent clause. Daniel, who was late again today, sits next to me in English. Antecedent Daniel, who Daniel, so the dependent clause means Daniel was late again today, who is replacing Daniel in the second clause and relating it to the subject of the independent clause. The relative pronoun has a grammatical function in the sentence. There is a mountain that we are going to climb, that is a direct object of the infinitive to climb. My blue tennis shoes, which used to be my mom's, were under the bed, which is the subject of the verb used. Daniel, who was late again today, sits next to me in English. Who is the subject of the dependent clause? Hint: when choosing between who and whom, consider how the pronoun is used in the dependent clause, not the independent clause. These are the students who are going. Who is the subject of the dependent clause? These are the students who are going, they are going. Those are students to whom I bought the tickets. Whom is the object of the preposition for? Those are students. I bought the tickets for whom? I bought the tickets for them. With understood pronoun, sometimes the relative pronoun is understood and not written in the sentence. Have you seen the book I lost? Have you seen the book that I lost? The teacher I had in fifth grade really inspired me. The teacher whom I had in fifth grade really inspired me. With prepositions, if the relative pronoun is the object of a preposition and is left out, the preposition has no choice but to dangle. In informal spoken English, this is fine. It is also fine in spoken English to end the clause with the preposition. However, in formal English, it is better to put the preposition before the pronoun. Note that the preposition is part of the dependent clause. This movie was the sequel we had been waiting for, informal. This movie was the sequel which we had been waiting for, informal. This movie was the sequel for which we had been waiting, formal. Do you know the actor Shelley is talking about, informal? Do you know the actor that Shelley is talking about, informal? Do you know the actor about whom Shelley is talking, formal? Note that that becomes whom or which. With relative adverbs, adjective clause can also start with the relative adverbs where, when, and why. They connect the dependent clause to a noun in the sentence. The relative adverb modifies the verb in the dependent clause. That is the bench where you and I were supposed to meet. 6 o'clock was the time when we were supposed to be there. That is the reason why I couldn't meet you. Essential and non-essential adjective clauses. Sometimes the information included in an adjective clause is very important to the meaning of the sentence. For cases in which the sentence wouldn't hold the same meaning without the clause, the adjective clause is called an essential clause. For example, I don't like children who eat ice cream with their hands. In this case, the adjective clause gives essential information to describe the children. If you got rid of that clause, the sentence would simply say, I don't like children, which is very different from not liking messy children who eat with their hands. An essential adjective clause does not require any additional punctuation. A non-essential adjective clause, on the other hand, gives extra description that is not strictly required to understand the writer's intent. For example, the kitten, which was the smallest of the litter, finally found a foster home. In this case, the adjective clause gives extra information, but it isn't necessary to get the gist of the sentence about the cat finding a home. Non-essential adjective clauses are set off with commas to show that they aren't as strongly connected to the rest of the sentence. Adjective clauses in use. Below are a few more examples of adjective clauses. See if you can determine which ones are essential and which are non-essential as you review them. Ask yourself, is the information necessary for the meaning of the sentence? Is punctuation required? The dog that I brought home from the pound was soon fast asleep. The time will come when you feel sorry for the things you've done. The smart teenager whose parents are my neighbors went to prestigious college. The used car which my dad bought last week broke down yesterday. The reason that Penelope failed the test is that she didn't study. Adding adjective clauses to your writing is a good way to provide additional detail about the noun and pronouns in your work. This extra description will enrich your writing and help the reader understand your message more clearly. When you know the relative pronouns and how to distinguish between essential and non-essential clauses, you'll have no trouble identifying adjective clauses and punctuating them correctly in your writing. And with all this talk of clauses, this may also be a good time to refresh your memory on independent and dependent clauses. Examples of adjective clauses. Here are some examples of adjective clauses. The carpets that you bought last year have rotted. The follies which a man regrets most in his life are those which he didn't commit when he had the opportunity. Even though it is a quotation by an American journalist, nowadays most writers in the US would use that instead of which. There is more on this below. Verb, a person who talks when you wish him to listen. So the components of an adjective clause. An adjective clause, also called a relative clause, will have the following three traits. Trait 1. It will start with a relative pronoun who, whom, whose, that or which, or a relative adverb when, where or why. This links it to the noun it is modifying. Quite often the relative pronoun can be omitted. However, with an adjective clause it is always possible to put one in. There is more on this below. It will have a subject and a verb. These are what make it a clause, is trait 2. Trait 3, it will tell us something about the noun. This is why it is a kind of adjective. Look at the three traits in this example. Quite often, the relative pronoun is the subject of the clause. Look at the three traits in this example. The relative pronoun can be omitted. It is common for the relative pronoun to be omitted. Look at this example. The carpets which you bought last year have gone moldy. The film which you recommended scared the kids half to death. The follies which a man regrets most in his life are those which he didn't commit when he had the opportunity. This is not always possible, though, for a person who talks when you wish him to listen. When the adjective clause starts with a relative adverb, when, where, or why, the relative adverb cannot be omitted. I don't remember a time when words were not dangerous. You can often omit a relative pronoun, but you can omit a relative adverb. So you cannot omit one in this example. Why should I care about adjective clauses? There are two common questions related to adjective clauses. Question 1. Should I use a comma before which? This is the by far the most common question related to adjective clauses. The answer applies to all adjective clauses, not just those that start with which. So, do you offset an adjective clause with commas or no? The answer is sometimes yes and sometimes no. The rule is this: don't use commas if your clause is essential. It is required to identify its noun. This is called a restrictive clause. Do use commas if your clause is just additional information. This is called a non-restrictive clause. If you happily put brackets around it or delete it, then use commas. Here is an example for non-restrictive clause. My brother who claimed to have a limp sprinted after the bus. This clause is not required to identify my brother. It is just additional information. My brother who claimed to have a limp sprinted after the bus. As it's just additional information, you can put it in brackets. My brother sprinted after the bus. As it's just additional information, you can even delete it. Compare this to a restrictive clause. The tramp who claimed to have a limp sprinted after the bus. This clause is required to identify the tramp. Without it, we don't know which tramp we are talking about. The tramp who claimed to have a limp sprinted after the bus. This sentence is only appropriate if we know which tramp we are talking about. The tramp sprinted after the bus. This sentence is only appropriate if we know which tramp we are talking about. Question 2. What's the difference between that and which? Which and that are interchangeable, provided we are talking about which without a comma. When which starts a restrictive clause, a clause not offset with commas, you can replace it with that. In fact, Americans will insist you use that instead of which for a restrictive clause. Mark's dog, which ate the chicken, is looking guilty, but in America, or at least widely disliked. Americans balk at which without a comma. They insist on that. Mark's dog that ate the chicken is looking guilty. This version is acceptable for all. It will stop you getting hate mail from Americans. For many, even breeds, that sounds more natural with a restrictive clause, and this is something we can use. If all this talk of restrictive and non-restrictive clauses is confusing, try replacing your which with that. If your sentence still sounds good, you almost certainly want which without a comma. This trick works because that can only be used with a restrictive clause, and whether you concisely know it or not, some language processing area of your brain does. The that substitution trick also works with who, but be aware that some of your readers might not like the used verb people. The burglar who assumed the homeowner was boot in court. The burglar that assumed the homeowner was boot in court. Substituting who for that is good way to test whether an adjective clause needs commas or not. But some of your readers might not like that being used for a person, even a burglar. So if your clause starting who sounds okay with that, then revert to who without commas. Top key points. If you'd happily delete your clause, then it's not a restrictive clause and it should be offset with commas. Don't start a restrictive clause with which if you are American or writing to Americans. Use that instead. Use who not that for people who is a bit sharper. An adjective clause is a clause that works to describe or modify a noun or pronoun. It will always be a subordinated clause. It appears immediately after the word it describes modifies. Adjective clauses always begin with either a pronoun or an adverb. Pronouns who, which, that, whom, whose, adverbs, why, were, when. Adjective clauses answer questions that begin with which, who, when, or what kind. An adjective clause must have the two parts of every clause. So, for example, a subject, what the clause is about, and the verb, what the subject is doing. The subject of an adjective clause depends on whether it begins with a pronoun or an adverb. A adjective clause beginning with a pronoun. When an adjective clause begins with a pronoun, the pronoun is the subject of the clause. So, it is summary. All adjective clauses are dependent clauses. Functions of adjective clauses, essential, non-essential adjective clauses. Adjective clauses answer questions, restrictive clause and non-restrictive clause. And questions, what is the role of adjective clauses? What is the function of adjective clauses? What are essential and not essential adjective clauses? What are the components of an adjective clause? And what questions are related to adjective clauses? And sources you can use in order to prepare for your practical lessons.